It says in the machinery directive that every control system, the safety control system, has to be fail safe. And it says in PUA that the failure of a control system or a safety control system must not lead to a dangerous occurrence. So how do we guarantee? How do we guarantee that machine manufacturers who have an emergency stop on are sure that if somebody presses that emergency stop, it will operate every time? It will stop the machine every time. How do we ensure that? Because if pressing that emergency stop fails and the machine keeps on going, then somebody could be in a problem. From my point of view, I don't think an emergency stop is there for the person in the problem. It's there for somebody to see somebody getting wrapped in this machine and say, I need to stop this machine and get that guy out. So how do I know when I press that emergency stop, it's going to have the desired effect? So there used to be a standard, and we've been with this standard for a long, long time, called EN 954, which was the integrity of safety control systems. Anybody heard of that? And what it did is it put you into categories, A through to 1 to 4. Sorry, B. Category B was domestic appliances. So what it said is that your safety devices on your domestic appliances must be fit for function. So if you take the vacuum cleaner, it's got a switch on which will interrupt the current, and it's got a fuse in the plug that hopefully will blow if there's a problem on it. So the safety devices are fit for function. Then it went on to categories 1 to 4, where it said, right, if you've got an emergency stop on a machine, a category 1, that's not a problem. You know, it's a very low risk machine anyway, and you have to test your emergency stop at regular intervals. Then it went to category 2, a bit more complicated machine or a bit more dangerous machine. And it said, again, all conditions of B apply, it must be fit for function. But now software logic is not allowed. So at category 2 of this standard, it says you can't put safety through software. Well, Siemens have just brought out an e-stop, emergency stop system, that works on Bluetooth, that is wireless. There's no, you don't connect a wire up to it. You just plug them in and then you switch on your, that scares the living day. I mean, I know I'm old and things like that, but I mean, I know I've got Bluetooth in my car, but I haven't got a clue how it works. I mean, it's named after a Norwegian king or something, isn't it? Or a Viking or somebody. So technology basically has taken over this standard. You know, I went on to an exhibition in Birmingham at the NEC, and there was this stand there, Why Guard Machines? And being sad, I thought, oh, I'm going to have to go on here. So I went on, this guy came up and he said, you know, why do you guard machines? I said, well, to keep people safe. Don't need that now. Old hat guarding, take it all off. He said, we can put a chip in your shirt collar or in your boots. He said, and then we can program the machine so if you walk near it, it'll switch off. It'll actually do better than that. It'll actually give you zones where if you walk so far near it, it'll say, hang on, you're getting near. Hang on, you're getting too near. Hang on, I've stopped. So, you know, he said, brilliant, feel safe. And I thought, never in a month of Sundays would I rely on this. You know, I've got the wrong shirt on today or something like that. But we are getting now where we can't get away from the fact, and hopefully most people will embrace it, that we can have now the technology where we can put our safety devices through software. And these are the two new standards, not so new now, but these are the standards that are driving this allowance for software-related safety devices or safety control systems. 13849 is the one that is being mostly used. It applies to every type of energy supply. pneumatic, hydraulic, electrical. BSEN 62061 is for purely electrical control circuits where your machine has no other energy supplies on it. This brings in, and I'm going to touch on it, but not a great deal, what we call performance levels. And this brings in what we call SIL levels, which are safety integrated levels. And I just want to sort of go through this in a basic sort of thing. But we now have three guys who are full-time employed helping companies comply with these standards because, to be honest, they are fairly difficult to comply with. There is a lot of mathematics in the standards and issues which I'll try and explain. But I don't want to go too far because everybody will just glaze over. So a control system responds to input signals from a machine or from an operator and generates an output signal, which makes the machine operate in a desired manner. So we press the start control or we press the stop control, etc. And that closes a contactor and energizes an electric motor and off we go. A safety-related control system in a machine should be regarded as being safety-related if it contributes to reducing any risk to an acceptable level or if it's required to function correctly to maintain and achieve safety. So if we go back to our little diagram, we go through a reset facility and we can start our machine together. So that interlock is providing us with a safety system. So that is a safety controlled system that we have on our machine. If we wanted to put some e-stops on there and there, them again would be regarded as safety related. And 13849 sends us down this well, it's called a riskograph, where we start at point one and we say, right, if this safety-related device fails, is it going to be a slight injury or is it going to be a severe injury? Now, if you look at our scenario, if that interlock fails, he's going to be in with a moving robot. So it's probably going to be a severe injury. Slight is normally reversible, but that's not if they sew the hand back on. Once the hand's come off, it's a severe injury. Serious, normally irreversible, injury or death. It doesn't get much worse than death, does it? So we have to make that decision that on our machine, and remember this applies to new machines, this applies to pure, but this is from machine manufacturers, this is an element that your client's going to start asking you for. Where's your validation to 13849? Because they are going to want to see that, so make sure that they're complying with PUA. So you're going to have to manufacturers produce these risk graphs and produce the actual element of how you've met this performance level. So S1, you come to F1, F2. Are you in there less frequently, F1, or F2, are you in there frequently? And it's the same that applies on S2 as well. So again, if we take our example, you know, how often are we going through these doors to change this reel here? How many pallets will this reel do? So are we going through 5 times a day? Does it run 24 hours? Is it run 7 days a week? So is it frequent access or less frequent access? And again, this is up in the air, what's frequent, what less frequent. The guarding standard 953 says that if you were going through an interlock door more than once in every 8 hour shift, then it's frequent access. So if I'm going through that more than once in every 8 hours to change that reel, then it's frequent. If it'll last for 2 days and I don't need to open these doors, then it's less frequent. So then we come to the possibility of avoidance. P1, it's fairly slow moving. There's a lot of room around. If it does start to move and I'm in there, I can get out the road. P2, hang on, it's moving at a fair speed. There's not a lot of room. If that starts moving, I've got problems. So you need to go through those decisions, whether it be on your new machine or on your old machines under Pure. And you will come out with a performance level. A, B, C, D, and E. And they do correlate to the old categories 1 to 4 on the other standard. And basically it's saying that A, B, and C, you need to check your safety devices, etc. D and E, they must be self-checking. So there's no chance, if there's a failure in the safety device, the machine will automatically to cut down. But the main difference between this standard and this one is, if I can just... If we had a normal stop, start circuit, going through an interlock or an e-stop there, what we used to say is, right, and then that goes through a contactor and under a motor. What we used to say is, right, if we get into category 3 or 4, then we need to dual channel these circuits and maybe have another contactor in. So if that one stuck in, that would operate. And it was all regarding the wiring of it. What's happened now is, under this standard, 13849, manufacturers are having to bring out data of their products. So if you're looking at an interlock, it will have data now. The manufacturer will have tested it and provide you with what's called an MTTD, which is the mean time to dangerous failure. So you can then say, right, okay, I'm going to go through this door 3 times a day. It's running 24 hours a day. It's running 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. The mean time to dangerous failure on that interlock is 18,000 operations. So in 7 years, that interlock might fail. So we need to change it in 6 years, 9 months. So you're getting this type of data now from manufacturers that you never did before. So anyway, I'm just going to go through a little bit and not too heavy, I promise you. An electrical standard, 62061, that is to be used when the safety of the machinery is controlled by a specifically designed safety PLC and can only be used in electrical installations. And these are some of the techniques we can use with 62061. PLCs, digital communication systems, internet-based technologies. So we can use this, and on big machines or big palletizer units or things like that, it makes sense. It keeps the cost down. It means you can program them better and easier. So what we can do is we run a two-wire system round our factory, and then we just plug in our safety devices into this two-wire system. On the case of Siemens, we don't have wires now. And then we have this hardware at the front that we look at. We've got a specific safety PLC, which is 3 different PLCs running in the same box, so you can't get common mode failure. Through a programmable unit, and then you can program your different safety blocks into what you want them to achieve and what you want them to do. Initially, German in the automotive industry, because it meant they've got flexibility. It's easy just to run 2 wires round to expand and change systems. And as long as that side is fairly complicated, this side is economically viable, because this is where your money is. So you have to weigh up whether, you know, if I'm going to buy all this hardware, is it going to save me money in the long run because I've got this flexibility and I've got this systems I can put in? If not, well, you go back to the old-fashioned way. 13849 is a direct replacement for 954. And that can use any energy source, and that's why it's more being used than other ones. And this is a chart where it says, you know, if you're using electrical only, you can use 602061, hardware, software, and a validation at the end. Non-complex assemblies, 13849, or if you've got pneumatics or hydraulics, again, 13849. And it puts you into the performance levels based on the safety-related parts and the control system. So it's based on the actual interlocks you're using, the actual e-stops you're using, because all of this, all of these components now have to come with this mean time to dangerous failure data. And you stick all this into a formula within 13849, and it tells you what you can achieve as far as your performance levels are concerned. We are dealing with a company now, and he's come out, and or the guy there has come out and said that every machine that they buy, their manufacturers is going to have to make sure it validates to PLE, which I think is a very tall order. Because PLE is the highest level of control, and it's self-checking, cross-monitoring, etc. And what he's saying is that they have a safe working procedure now where every morning the operator has to test all the safety devices on the machine. So he tests each e-stop, each interlock. He doesn't need to do that if it's PLE because it's self-checking, it's self-testing. So he's going to save time on his operators and produce more widgets. There's a four-level approach, four-stage approach. Perform a risk assessment. Allocate a safety measure. So you would look at your risk assessment on your interlock. You would then go through your riskograph to come to a performance level. You then devise a system of architecture that is suitable for that performance level. Okay, you put in what e-stops and what interlocks you want, you design your safety circuit, and then you put all of that information, all the MTTDs of that safety circuit, into some fairly hefty calculations that will validate that your design is actually meeting this performance level. And I don't know whether you've heard, but anybody heard of Sistema? Pascal? There are systems out there that you can download. Well, Sistema is certainly free, where you can download all these libraries and everything, and you put the data in, and Sistema will come out and say, yes, I'm meeting that performance level, or actually, no, you're not. And it might be new now, but it is something that you're going to be hit with. I see more and more companies now are saying to people, you know, right, I'm going to buy this machine off you. What's the performance level? Show me the validation you're actually meeting this performance level. And it's only a matter of time. And one of the things that is unsettling is that they're already trying to rewrite these two standards into one standard. And to be honest, as far as I'm concerned, it's very, very difficult to do this maths and this equation as it is. If they're trying to amalgamate the standards, it's going to make it even worse. But, you know, it can take, on a fairly simple machine, you know, our guys have been through courses and things like that. On a fairly simple machine, which has a few e-stops and a few interlocks, you're looking at 2 to 3 days to do the validation and everything and the systems architecture. It's not a quick thing. If you were building complex machinery, you know, you need to flag up that sooner or later this is going to come back and hit you, and somebody's going to say to you, right, where's your performance level validation and your performance level category that you've come to? And unfortunately, again, it's not going to go away. It's probably going to get worse. And these are the new sort of hybrid standards that are coming round. Has anybody come across these yet? No. You will. Unfortunately, I would fairly much be guaranteed that that'll happen. But yeah, they can be fairly complicated. But it's technology. It's allowed technology to move on. So we get, you know, we're getting camera systems now that are now safety certified, where you can sit a camera above your machine, and this camera will again zone where you can walk, where you can't walk. And when you get into one zone, it'll say you're approaching the danger zone. Into zone two, you're getting very near. Zone three, I'm switching off. So we've now got CCTV cameras that have been certified as safety devices under these standards. So it is moving on. you get anybody have used scanners or anything like that? Have you come across scanners or anything? Because scanners at the present moment, the manufacturers can't get above PLD for a scanner. So you can't make a PLE machine if it's got a scanner on, because there isn't such a thing as a PLE scanner. Right, well, seeing you've never heard of them, there'd be no questions on that, will there? Right. And as I think, personally, this needs to lead on to where, if you are buying machinery or if you're building it, that you get a specification together. Because I think if you put a specification together at the beginning of the job, it makes life easier as you go through that job. You don't want to get to the end and the client turn around to you and say, well, I want a PLE machine, I've always wanted one. Well, it's not in your specification. Yeah, but I've always wanted. It's too late then. It's going to cost you a fortune to re-engineer this machine to meet PLE. So if you agree on things like that at the beginning, you don't have the arguments at the end. And we work with a number of companies now where we're actually looking at helping them with these specifications, because they realise the importance. This was two small injection moulding machines. Well, there was actually five of them. That this company, the manufacture batteries, this company, and they bought these from America, and they just said, we want some injection molding machines, this power, whatever, whatever, and that's what come across. What they actually had to do is to retrofit them like that to actually make them CE compliant. And the American manufacturer said, not our problem, you didn't specify what you want. So again, that caused a lot of bad blood. It also delayed these machines going into operation. It cost the company a lot of money to upgrade them to meet CE requirements. So, you know, certainly, you know, from both parties, I think it's essential that you introduce, you know, what we call a user requirement spec, a URS, because it'll let things flow a lot easier. We get a lot where we inspect machines in the manufacturers before they are actually transported to the facility, because it's easier to pick up any issues in the facility than it is once it's in the client's factory. And these are just a few notes on what standards you need to be complying with or the manufacturer needs to, so you both agree with that. Any local regulations that you need to be adhering to. You know, if it was going to the US, is there any OSHA standards, US standards? You know, and if it's for Europe, not limited to all applicable European directives and CE mark. And we can go through these, you know, what needs to be included. You know, you can change this if you haven't got one, or if you're looking at putting one together. of what requirements should be in there.